All right, bye for now.
Bye. Yes.
What can I do for you?
Are you coming to the meeting?
Yeah, sorry, I'm not there yet. I'm just getting on right now.
Okay. Fritz just had to go to a case, but he said he'd be back in about 10. We just need to do our positive focuses and everything.
Okay, I'm coming on just as soon as I can.
Okay, you going to call Caroline?
Oh, is she not on yet?
No.
Yeah, I'll give
her a call. Bye. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can.
Okay.
What are you living in the barn now?
Yeah, I'm in the barn. It's kind of where I got my living room.
Oh, wow.
Hey, do you know where KK is?
She's in the bathroom. She's getting out of the shower.
Okay. All right, well, we've got our meeting here pretty soon, and so me, Fritz, and Dad are on, and so we just, usually she's on it before we are, so we were just making sure she was okay. Yeah.
Okay, I will let her know, and she has
not
had her dinner, so
I'll
probably bring some
mulch in
the salad.
Is there
any baby
kind of
hungry?
I bet. All right. Well, sounds good.
I'll let her know you're ready.
Okay, love you. Oh, thanks so much for the text the other day, too. The girl, it made my day.
Happy birthday!
So, and Dad says, happy birthday!
Thank you,
he's early. Yeah, he's a little early.
Not much. Not much.
All right. Love you. Bye.
Bye.
Yeah, so KK gets on. I'll show you around my little living room here. But slowly I've turned my barn into kind of my living room. That one area. Hey, KK, I just talked to your mama. Can you hear me?
Yeah,
hey, look at my barn. There's the front door of my barn. And then this is my living room.
Wow.
My barn. There's my TV in my barn. But I got couches set up. And then there's a table where we play cards.
Nice.
But anyway, so I'm slowly, it's just so beautiful outside. And there's the boys. They're in my chair. Aww. Just got sat on.
You're getting squished.
Any Hooterville, Fritz ran off to go do a procedure. So we're going to start with positive focus. My positive focus is that my carpet this week, and the cabinets came in, so they're in the kitchen ready for Bo to put them up. The laundry room is done, and then I have a nice living area out in the barn now. So after like so long, I feel like I'm actually getting closer to being at home. Feels like a home instead of a project. And Brandon's been coming on the weekends, and so it's just, it's getting nicer. But my cocoa is just that we got all the flooring in, and that makes such a difference to make it turn from a house to a home. So I'm excited about that.
Nice.
So, Dad, what's your cofo?
I got all of the gravel cleaned up today. I've got a load on the truck to be spread whenever I have time. And got you done. So that's one big job down and a monster coming up.
Yep.
So hopefully by Wednesday evening, I will be done to where I can do gravel on Wednesday, maybe, or Thursday rather, Thursday and Friday.
Okay. Hmm. Moving right along with all our to-do list things.
What's KK's foe?
My positive focus is that we did an Alzheimer's walk this morning at the zoo, and that was tons of fun. It was like a 3-mile walk for Alzheimer's disease, and that was really fun. And then everybody came back here, and we had like this huge brunch, and it was great.
So that was with Sammy and Alex?
Yeah, Sammy, Alex, Aunt Laura, Uncle Dan, David, Grandpa, Aunt Debbie, Uncle Todd, Ma, and Amy.
Oh, really? Cool.
Mm-hmm. Everyone.
Oh, good. It's exciting. Yeah, I saw the Snapchats. They were awesome.
Did you see
the Meerkats?
Oh, yeah, those were at the zoo, and I was like, oh my gosh, little meerkats. I kept taking pictures, and then Uncle Todd told me, he's like, all right, Caroline, you gotta let the other people see the meerkats. And I was like, otherwise, there would have been more, but I got scolded, so.
Well, cool. Well, what do we want to talk about first from the 7 Habits?
I don't even know.
Is this your first time with the 7 Habits, or was this more just of a clarification, or?
It was pretty much my first time.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, I know we've talked about it on here before a little bit, like, briefly, uh-huh. And that's about as much as I know. So.
Okay. The way it always seemed to me, like, the first one means that you're supposed to make yourself the writer of the software. The second is where you write it, and then the third is where you actually go and do it.
You run the software.
So if you kind of keep that little idea in mind, it's easy. that try to remember, you know, be proactive, you know, start with the end in mind, and then put first things first, you know.
Okay.
So I think those are the big ones that I always thought you had to work on, you know. And if you don't get those down, you can't really get into the others.
Okay.
Yeah. Pretty much.
So. Was there anything that you heard that you don't understand, or something that had an impact on your life that said something to you?
Me?
Yeah.
I was confused when he started talking about the quadrants.
That's a totally different area, and we haven't gotten into that yet, right?
Okay, then I was like, yeah. So confused, what are you talking about? Okay.
Right.
So he kind of explains, you know how like a lot of us will say, I just didn't have enough time to do it.
Yeah.
Or, you know, I just couldn't make time for it. Well, he kind of says there's four quadrants. So, quadrant one is, and I may be a little bit off on this, but one of the quadrants is you spend time on things that are urgent and unimportant. So, it'd be like a phone call from a telemarketer. You'll stop everything to answer that phone call because it's urgent, and you find out it's unimportant because it was a telemarketer. You didn't need them anyway. So if you spend time on that, you're taking away time from something else, obviously. The another quadrant would be urgent and important. So that'd be like a water leak at one of our rental houses. That's both urgent and important. It needs to be taken care of. And so that's urgent and important. That's another quadrant.
And he says that is where the seven habits fall into, Kay.
No.
Because, yes.
The seven habits fall into the important and not urgent.
The seven habits?
Yes, fall into quadrant two, which is urgent or not urgent and important. So it's things like sharpening your saw. It's things like these calls. They're not urgent. Nothing's going to fall apart if we don't do these. But these are the most important things. It's like making your mission statement. It's not urgent, but it's important. So those are the things that you have to, that you try to make, spend the most of your time doing.
Right, right.
And then at the end of the week, you feel fulfilled because you got done the most important things.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, there's the four different quadrants, but quadrant four is where he says we need to spend most of our time, which is why he always likes for people to plan a week. Which is why kind of I think Fritz sets these up weekly. It's because if you do things day to day, all you're doing is fighting fires all the time. But if you say at the end of the week, this is what I want to get done for next week, and then you focus that week on those important things, make sure you take care of. So he likes a week of planning rather than just day to day.
So is that something like also where you should just like figure out what, like even just for your schedule, figure out what you're doing for the whole week and figure that out? Or is it more of like your goals and everything?
Both.
Okay.
What do you think, Dad?
That's right.
So, I kind of got, on Sundays I sometimes get anxiety because of the meetings, and I think, am I prepared? Did I do everything? yada yada. And when I get anxious, it's because I have spent more time in quadrants rather than my quadrant two. If I would have spent time in my quadrant two more, making sure that the important things got done, that were on my list, then I'm never worried about my Sunday call. Because I know that the things that are important and the things that are on my list, they've gotten taken care of, because that's what I'm held accountable for. It was interesting because I hadn't listened to the videos until today. And today, like, 2 o'clock rolled around, and I'm like, oh, my God, I haven't listened to the videos. And I haven't looked at my list to make sure I got everything else done, yada, yada. And I got really anxious because I hadn't put first things first. And so it was interesting that we did this video for me, because then I was able to see exactly why I was totally anxious about everything. So,
Kate, this is what Fritz considers to be one of the more important ideas in making your life better, because it's by following these 7 habits and then the 8th one that you actually will do more with your life and enjoy it more. Because you're the one that's going to make that mission statement that says what it is in life you really care about, you know. And it's just like number 2, you know, you're the author, you write the software. And then once you've got it written, number 3 is do it. So if you can follow this and everything, you'll get more out of your life. And a lot of us don't, you know. And one of the big ones, without a doubt, is number 2, where you actually sit down and figure out what is important in your life. You know. So.
Yeah.
I mean, Fritz tries to read this book every year if he can. And I don't know how many times he has read it, but he's always quoting from it.
Yeah.
Because he really does think that this is one way that it's going to really help you have a better life. So.
And ask your dad. Your dad's read it. Because I remember the first time, or the second time I was reading it, I was at your house. And your dad had read it and had taken on some of the practices, and he knew everything that I was talking about. It was really cool. So your dad knows this book and has read it, and I don't know if they used it at his company when I was over or what, but mm-hmm. Yeah, it was interesting because he knew about it.
Well, actually, DJ and I talked about it earlier, but we talked mainly about the first 3. I think if you get those down as a good foundation, the rest of it will follow and everything. But you've really got to work on being in charge of your life, figuring out what it is that you really want, and then doing those important things and let all the little stuff kind of filter wherever it will.
I still
struggle with that.
I do too. I get caught up in all the little things. Like, I'm overwhelmed with all the things that need to be done at the new property, but then I have to stop and remember, we got this new property to enjoy it. So this morning, Brent and I went out on the Jeep and we drove around in the woods. And that's it. Like, we just took time to enjoy it. And then today we have lots of stuff to do, but we took time this afternoon, about 45 minutes, and we hung out. We moved the couches around and we hung out in the couches on the barn, in the barn. Because as a mission statement, one of my goals, or one of my priorities is to enjoy life. And I enjoy when I'm relaxing.
Mm-hmm.
And I know a lot of people don't enjoy when they're relaxing. But I enjoy relaxing.
Drives me crazy.
Yeah, mom doesn't.
Yeah, your mom couldn't do it either. Just, and that's not one of her priorities. Me, it is. It's important to me. I really like relaxing. And I want to do more of that. So I have to make time for that, or else my job and the people that are around me will keep me hopping constantly. But that's not the program I'm writing. I'm writing a program where I take off and spend time with my family. I get to have a relationship with you and with Claire and whoever else, because I make that a priority. So, like Dad said, you write the book and then you go do it.
So you have to do these in order, right?
Yeah, pretty much. Yep. But if you don't have a mission statement, it doesn't mean you can't listen to number 3 and 4 and 5 and understand what they're talking about. Because I got hung up, because like Fritz had said last week, you can get hung up on number 2, making your mission statement, for years. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't get hung up on any of them. Just keep going. Have number 1 before you can have number 2. You have to have number 2 before you can have number 3. But read them all and understand them, and then.
So can we talk about them in order and how to apply those to our lives then?
Can we ever?
Absolutely. Perfect idea.
Hey, I just heard this. Okay, I was listening to a YouTube while I was taking a run downstairs, mm-hmm. And he said have it 1 through 3. This is the first time I've heard this. He said, habit 1 through 3 can be described in 4 words. Make and keep promises. Hmm. If you can do that, to you can do all of the public, or all the private victories are in just those things. To make and keep promises. Now, how would that be for habit 1?
Make promises to yourself that you're going to get your stuff done.
I mean, what does that have to do with habit 1? What's habit 1?
Proactivity.
Proactive. Mm-hmm. So that
do
means
it.
Make a promise. I mean, thank you for
Hey, Dad.
I think it's the room Dad's in. I really think it's that room.
I know. It is. It is. Like, it couldn't be more reflective or loud. Like, it's impossible for that room to be worse for that. Okay.
Okay, so 1, be proactive. Make the promise. Decide to make and keep promises.
The fact that you get to decide.
I feel like there could even be a step before this. Or, like, one that you incorporate into all of it. And I feel like self-discipline should be a step or something. Because you have to have self-discipline in order to be proactive and all the other stuff.
Absolutely. Where does self-discipline fit into all of this? Is it just kind of an underlying...
So... the founder of Strategic Coach, his name is Dan Sullivan, and he says that there is no such thing as discipline. What he says is that we all adhere to our habits. We're all perfectly disciplined to our habits. So as long as we form it as a habit, we don't have to worry about discipline. The people kind of get hung up on discipline, and they use willpower to do discipline. And this is how the willpower and habits fits in, right? If we think we have to be disciplined for it, then it doesn't work. Like, Covey will talk about discipline, and how he talks about it is, like, discipline and freedom. He's like, You think that they're exactly the opposite, but they're exactly the same. He would say, I'm not since I didn't discipline myself to do piano practice, in other words, I'm not in the habit of doing or playing piano, I don't have the freedom to sit down to a piano and play. So not like, I don't know how exactly discipline fits in, but there's a little bit of at least a thought on it, maybe.
Yeah. I feel like discipline still exists. It's just that guy's perspective of discipline is so that there isn't any discipline. It just happens. But that's just his perspective.
Now, that's perfect, Kay, because think about that. Perspective is all that you have anyway, because what is real anyway? Only what your perspective is. So if discipline doesn't serve you, then don't believe in it. Think about that. If he could have a life without discipline and never having to worry about discipline because he says that it doesn't exist and he has a successful life, who's to tell him there's such a thing as discipline?
Just an idea.
That's kind of radical, right? It's off to one side the whole way. It's crazy, a little off to one side. But maybe it's not that crazy, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, like if you get power out of thinking about discipline, then it's good for you. If it's negative energy for you, then maybe you have to come up with a new perspective on it.
That's a good idea.
Because who wants to be like, oh, I want to have discipline? Nobody wants that. They use it as a negative term, like, you're going to get disciplined.
Yeah.
What good is that? Nobody wants that in their life. Who the hell wants to be disciplined?
Yeah.
Okay. So.
I'm glad you watched this, too, because I don't know if I was talking about it on this call, or if I was just talking to Anna about it. How I'm such a procrastinator. Did I tell all of you guys about that?
When you say that, what does it mean?
I'm not proactive.
We've talked about identity, right?
Mm-hmm.
Malcolm Gladwell, when I was... That is his speech last week. He talked about the frog and the scorpion. Now, you guys have all heard this story, right?
I don't think so. I don't remember it.
There's a frog and a scorpion. The scorpion needs to get to the other side of the river. He yells at the frog, who's in the middle. He's like, hey, frog, let me jump on your back and get me over to the other side of the river, will ya? And the frog's like, I don't think so. Oh, like... You're a scorpion. You sting frogs. And I'll die. He's like, you're not using your little frog brain. Like, if I sting you when we're halfway across, I'm going to drown and I'm going to die too. So it doesn't do me any good to kill you, now does it? The frog's like, well, that seems reasonable. Okay, fine. They get halfway across. The scorpion stings the frog. The frog goes down. The scorpion's going down too. But on his last breath, the frog goes... Why did you sting me? He says, I'm a scorpion. I sting frogs. So what's the point of that?
Scorpion was saying that was his identity.
Scorpion, that is his identity. He didn't care if he had to die. He'll die for his identity. In other words, whatever you identify with yourself. So if you say, I'm a procrastinator, be real careful with that.
I don't want to be a procrastinator.
Then don't call yourself one. No, don't call yourself one. Well, you can call yourself something else. You can say,
okay. You
can say, I'm working on doing things even earlier. I'm there somebody who gets things done. Even if you procrastinate, you get things done, now don't you?
Yeah.
Well then...
Brant says, because I've called him a procrastinator, and he doesn't say that. He says, I I need more motivation right now. He'll tell me what he needs. I need more motivation. I just need more motivation to do this.
See, that's great. He's looking for a solution as opposed to focusing on a problem. Saying that you're a procrastinator, what does that open up your mind to do? Just to look for ways that you're a procrastinator. And when you look for them, you'll find them.
And it makes you a victim.
Right. Right? And what, it doesn't put you in a positive place, right? So don't call yourself that. Right. You're not a procrastinator. Even if you do things sometimes, it's a difference between having an identity and a behavior. Saying that you procrastinate sometimes is very different than calling yourself a procrastinator. Mm-hmm. It may seem kind of semantics, but it's completely an awesome ideal. To say, I'm an achiever, I achieve, I kick ass and take names. Does that mean you never fail? No, you'll fail. Everybody fails sometimes. Most great achievers fail a lot of the time, but they'll never call themselves a failure. Right? Rich dad, poor daddy, always said that he was rich. Always. He may have been broke, but he was rich in his mind before he became wealthy. Mm-hmm. Just an idea.
Money stresses me out sometimes, Kay. And so I decided a long time ago that I would tell myself
son of a bitch, I do have them. Yeah, I do.
They're
in my pocket.
Always.
They're in my pocket. We're good.
That I'm always going to be that I'm always going to be financially okay. And so saying that made me believe it, and then I know that that's what's going to happen. I'm always going to be all right financially. And so I just kind of believe that because that's what I told myself, because I know that that gets me stressed out. And when there's times when I'm not financially okay, I just say, all right, well, how can I work on this? But at least I didn't stress about it the whole time. Or so I kind of made myself be different. So if I get overwhelmed sometimes, or I hate going to the dentist, scares me to death, just makes me freak out. So instead, I just pretend I'm not going to the dentist, and I go there, and then I sit in the waiting room and think about other things, and then I get in the chair and I talk to the person, and I don't think about what's going to happen, that he's going to put a shot in my mouth. I don't think about that till it's happening, and then I'm like, oh, God. But that only lasts a second, and then you're numb, and you're like, this is easy. But I'm the type of person that can, and then you can fill in the blank and make you whatever type of person you want to be.
That's habit one right there.
Oh, well, I have a long way to go.
And
not
that's
really.
Okay, we all do. I'm not 30, really. And
you
I
get
still
it.
Do this.
Okay, you get to create it however you want, and even as you pick something and it doesn't stick for you, you get to pick something else. You pick whatever the heck you want. It doesn't make any difference. There's no wrong answer.
Okay.
Just try which one actually empowers you. What actually empowers you?
Nothing. That I know of.
You've tried everything. All million and a half things that you could be, and none of them work for you, huh?
Well, no. For not procrastinating.
All right, let's not use the word procrastinate.
Okay,
Let's not have a not in front of it either. What do we actually want to do? What's the positive way to put this? Instead of a not in front of it, what's a positive way? What do you actually want out of it? What's the opposite of procrastinate?
Get myself proactive. Get my stuff done early, not stress, and have anxiety, and get it done.
Well, which part? Let's really think about it. Because hey, you get it all done. You get it done anyway, right? Even if you procrastinate, you get it done.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then, you already get it done regardless. So your body knows that you already get it done, so who cares if you procrastinate?
I care.
Why? Why?
Because when I procrastinate, then I think, like, I feel like I get really bad anxiety, and I think of all the different things. I just lay down on my bed, and I'm just like, I'm just going to go on Pinterest because I don't even want to think about this stuff. Then I completely avoid it.
Dang it. We are like...
So what you don't want...
I'm going to put a ball on the couch and go, I'm just going to forget this and take a nap instead.
Mm-hmm. I did that yesterday. And then... Actually, no, it was Friday. And then I'm all worked up. When I wake up, I'm like, oh, crap, I could have been doing this. And like, oh, my gosh, I have to do this. And then, like, I write it all down, and I'm like, okay, good. I got to start, and I wrote it all down. And then I look at the list, and it's a really big list because I keep thinking of things.
So when do you start the list?
What?
When do you start the list, or do you start the list?
I do start the list. Once I get to the point where I'm, like, it hits me where I'm like, crap, I really have to start on this now so I'm not, like, freaking out the entire night, then I have to start on it. Because, like, my list today, I started on it, like, at, like, 2 o'clock today, and I still have a lot to do after this.
So do you feel bad now, and you're like, man, I wish I would have started at 8 so that I could be done now?
Yeah.
So you want to get... So you want to be the type of person that gets stuff down early.
Yeah, but... Yeah.
Why? I mean, yeah. Why? What's the reward for that?
It just makes me feel better. Like, I like being able to just be on these calls and not have to have all of this other stuff preoccupying my brain, because it's all preoccupying my brain. So then I keep thinking about, like, oh, I really have to do this. How long is this going to take me once I get off the call? And, like, I keep trying to calculate how long everything's going to take me and what I have to do.
It stresses you out. It sounds like it stresses you out.
It does.
What's one thing that you have not gotten done early in the past that you would like to get done early for next week?
Like, in general, like, my weekend homework, like, that's something that what you're asking for?
That can be one thing. So that's something you usually wait till when to get done?
Oh, yeah, my homework, I usually wait till the last day.
Okay. Like, Sunday night.
Yeah.
So how would you feel, like, if you close your eyes, how would it feel if you were done with all of your weekend homework by Saturday night?
I've done this before, and it feels great. And I'm like, yes, I have the whole entire day. Sunday, I can just do whatever I want, and I can chill, and I can go to Walt's baseball game because I don't have homework, and I can go spend more time with the family. And it's good. It never happens.
Why doesn't it happen? Do you have, like, plans on Saturday night or Saturday afternoon? Like, are there activities that get in the way?
Sometimes, yeah.
And then Friday night, you don't make it a point to do it Friday after school because you're like, woohoo, it's the last, you're like, I'm just done with school?
Yeah.
Caroline, when DJ and I were talking about this audiobook earlier today, and we were only working on the first 3, right? Mm-hmm. And I told her, I said, okay, put down number 2. What do you really want to get done today? What's important that you get done today? And she said her homework. And I said, okay, don't put anything else down. If you think that's the main thing that you need to get done today, then just do it. Well, she ended up having to take care of Eunice quite a few hours. And, of course, she wasn't able to get a whole lot done, but she kept hitting it. And when I was up there around 6 o'clock to grab a quick bite to eat, she said that she was just about done, taking her all day. And she had these other little things that interfered, like taking care of the baby. But she was able to get that one main thing done. So I use this a lot when I talk about Fritz, you know, to where he was focused, he knew where he wanted to go, and he didn't go to one side or the other. He just stayed on track pretty much. And this is what you have to do in order to get things done. This will alleviate your procrastination a lot. You know, you just say, when you get out of school Friday, what do I want to get done by Saturday night? And if it's your homework, then get it done. That way you can enjoy Sunday.
If it's just like Dad's saying, like if it's the homecoming, if that's number one, like, oh, a homecoming football game, that's number one for me. Number two is Pinterest. Number three is homework. Well, then you start with the most important, and if homecoming isn't right away, then you go to number two. You just make sure that you just start at the beginning and don't stop. Right? We've talked about that one before a little bit, right? Where we've talked about, like, just starting at the very top of the list. Like, you want to see my list? Watch this. You ready for this? I'll share with you my list here.
For next week.
Can you see the list?
Mm-hmm. I see emails. There we go. No,
that's not what I want you to see. This list here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yoga and meditation. Monday.
This is 7 pages long.
Is this for this week, or is this just...
This is a running list.
Okay.
I utilize this list. I also utilize my calendar. The things from the calendar that need to be done that day and stuff like that, I'll put on here.
Yep.
Now look at this. This is my mission. Starts off, mission statement, primary questions, the virtues, the values. That stuff I see every day whenever I pop this open. It's always page one, right? That's kind of the mission statement that he's talking about. Right after that, it's what needs to get done. What do you think the probability of me looking up Resource Entrepreneur, that's about a website that I want to develop. What do you think the probability of me making it to page 3 is tomorrow? I'll tell you when. I put that on there in March. It hasn't worked its way up the list. And you know what? Will I get pissed off if I don't get to it tomorrow? No, because it's appropriately placed in the priority of first things first. It's not near the top. Okay? I have it here. It's captured, so I can pull it to the top if it becomes more important. Otherwise, what am I going to do tomorrow? I'm going to get all the things off Voxer in the morning and compile all my notes so I can tell people, I've been at things for 3 weeks. I need to get everybody all the learning that I put together. That needs to happen. I need to fill out my dashboard and do my constant never-ending improvement presentation for tomorrow for the team. Mm-hmm. This one has to do with, like, NHCPS seeing about, like, its SEO. I have a set, and that's all before my 6:30 a.m. call with Jared. I get my medication refilled, then I'm going to call your mom and tell her happy birthday. Then I'm going to change Dad's appointment with Rosenthal, deposit money. Like, I'm going to scout out Jenny's Pinterest page to look for some gift ideas, because by then I'll be tired.
Yeah.
Okay, now if I actually make it to a lot of this other stuff, then that's great. Otherwise, it'll have to wait till Tuesday.
Okay.
But like they said in Wizard of Oz, like, or what was it?
Alice in Wonderland.
Alice in Wonderland. Start at the beginning, go until the end, and then stop. There it is. Always.
Yeah,
no, what do you mean?
I can run a lot of parallels with what you're saying.
I'm not sure that's going to work.
Brant noticed that I get really...
All right. I'm calling him up. I'll call him up right now.
Because I'm not really prepared for the calls because I don't listen to the videos until Sunday afternoon. So I procrastinate. Not that I'm a procrastinator. But I do with this. And so he said, I don't want you to be unhappy on Sundays and get worked up.
Right. What's the probability of us getting started today?
And I said, well, these are the things that have worked for me. and these are the things that don't work for me.
And you ready for the patient?
I'm going to listen to the video on Friday, and I'm going to fill out my dashboard on Friday, and I'm going to finish up everything on Friday.
Rather than he's ready. We can go on back.
That way on
of course,
Sunday,
obviously, he's ready.
I can enjoy
he's been waiting for us. Yeah, right.
I love the calls. I don't love the anxiousness I get beforehand. So I can be all prepared if I do it on Friday. So we put it in my calendar that every single Friday it says, fill out your dashboard, listen to the iLive videos, and prepare for your meetings. I've moved it back to Friday so that my anxiety doesn't make my Sunday negative, because these Sunday things are some of the most positive things that I do all week. I don't want them being clouded with a negative air. So we backed those up. And then we said, okay, how can you make sure you do it on Friday? Well, I'll check on Wednesday and make sure I'm on track. And on Monday, I'm going to make a list. So Monday morning, if I don't have the list in hand, which today I'm early, I already have my list for this week. It's right here, my to-do list for the week. But if I don't have that by Monday morning, it's on my Monday morning calendar. The first thing you do is you make your priority list for the week. And then
that's straight from Covey.
That's my thing for the week. And if there's other things that come up that I need to make sure I get done, I'll put them in here. But then on Wednesday, I make sure it's on my calendar. I look at this and make sure that I've gotten my important things done. And then on Friday, I'm going to fill out my dashboard, which means everything's going to be done, or else I can't fill out my dashboard. And then I'll listen to my iLive calls and be ready for this one, too. Then I don't get anxious on Sunday. And I don't procrastinate till the last day and think, well, I didn't get this done, and now it's Sunday. I can't call them. It makes me feel worse to tell people I didn't get my stuff done than it does them. And so, you know, Brent was able to help me figure out. And so, like Fritz was saying with lists, that's also something that I can do. So.
And you have to find the tools that work for you, okay, you know. But Covey's a big one, like whenever you get into kind of more and more and more of his stuff. Like even on this one, I think he talked about like day-to-day planning. He's like, he doesn't believe in the day-to-day planning. Week increments must be no unit of increments time less than a week. So for me, it's always quarter. I do everything by year, and then I break it down into quarter, which is 3 months. Then I'll do a monthly update every single month. And then here, I'll show you something else that like this is the dashboard Jared and I go through. Have I shown
dashboard?
Yeah.
It's just a sheet that we share. It's like a sheet that we share. It's a little bit different. Like this one's a little bit different than other ones. So I don't want to confuse the terms. So check out this one. Okay, you see this piece of paper?
Not yet.
How about now?
Yeah.
Okay. In this sheet of paper, we do this every month. Monthly update. Tells how you're feeling emotionally. 0 to 10. How's revenue? Business. What are the top 3 things and why are they screwed up? Objectives. What are the biggest 3 things you're wanting the other person to hold you accountable for 3 months? How are they going? Other updates, like your highs and lows. Only the stuff you only share with just very, 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 very few people. Like, what are the things that are most pissing you off, and what are the things that are most awesome in your life? The very, very, very highs and lows. That way you capture it every month. This keeps you on track. You do this all the time. This is the exact same sheet that I do with Forum and VO, where we'll talk about, like, what was the greatest thing. Like, for me, personally, one of the greatest thing for this last, did you see this? Asked to be a keynote at my nephew's career day. That was the personal high for me for the whole last month. Right?
Yeah.
Cool.
So... There's a lot of cool things. They even have here, Cress is over on Labor Day. Right here, as being a family high.
Do you have a blank outline of that?
Yeah, I have a blank outline. Would you like it?
Yeah, we can send that over. That might be something fun to do. You can find a buddy and do it. Like Caroline and I could do it with each other, or Caroline and her mom could do it, or me and Brant, or.
Yep, I absolutely can. We usually do it for EO, and what they do there is like, these are like, you want to get into the things that are like very nitty gritty for you. Like, you only share with just a few people. You don't share with many people. It's a very, very personal type thing. You don't throw it out to everyone.
Sure.
Like all those things. But then they can help keep you accountable for that kind of stuff. But at least that way, like, you're actually thinking about it too. But anyway, that's a little off track. But all of those go back to it all goes back to seven habits. Like, what are all of those things? Those are sharpening the saw, which is habit what? Remember?
Sharpen the saw, 5?
Dad? Dad knows it.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Dad, are you even there?
Yes, but I'm muted so I don't disturb.
Well, as long as you're not moving around, you don't disturb. But go on. What is it? Do you remember?
7.
Yeah.
Sharpening your saws, number 7.
Oh, yeah. Dad knows. He's got it. All right. See here? Have you guys seen this this representation of the 7 habits? So dependence, independence, interdependence. Do you know what those are, Kay?
Dependence is with dependence on someone else. Independence is on your own. I don't know what interdependence is. Like in the middle.
Dad, can you help her?
It's your stages in life, Kay. When you're first born, you're very dependent, just like Eunice is right now for everything. About the time you get to be 10 or 12, you start to become very, very independent. Some people achieve that, and some people don't at an early age. And what we're all striving for is the interdependence, where we are dependent on each other to get things done in life and make our lives better. You know, it's just like Anna and Brent, are trying to get into that interdependent stage right now, where they're trying to work together and everything, just like your dad and his co-workers would be interdependent in order to get things done, and that's why they have all their committee meetings and so forth and so on. Mm-hmm. So, but that's what we're trying to achieve. And the big circle around it all is that sharpening of the saw, where you continually try to work on, getting better all the time at all of these. Because just like that bottom private victory, like I said, you've got to achieve that first. Once you've got that achieved, then you can go on to the public, sector of your life. So that's the way I see it.
Now, Stephen tried really hard to the reason I really like this particular audiobook is because it examines the opposites. Uh-huh. Like, he teaches all of them by teaching the opposite. So, like, if we're just starting with number 1, be proactive. Do you remember what the opposite of that was?
People don't take responsibilities for their own lives.
Right. They're a victim, right?
Yeah.
Somebody else is holding them back. Someone else won't let them do something. Blame on someone else. Blame on something else. Always have something to blame, right?
The way he was describing them, they sounded bitter.
They could be.
Just, I mean, not that they are, but just some of the words he threw out.
Yeah.
And I liked how he actually presented it, because, like, he says, like, I'm not here to judge, like what they've been oppressed by, or, like, how bad it was, or whatever. But, like, there's a space between stimulus and response. The more you can draw that space out, because in that space is where all of your happiness and all of your growth happens. Just in that space. So that's the most profound single line in all of Seven Habits, is between stimulus, response, the space. Because if you can draw that out, you can realize that you're responsible. You're the programmer for this. Like, this is why I really wanted you to, this is one reason why I wanted you to put together your website, okay? You're the programmer. You can do it. You can be proactive and you can actually do a website. You can begin with the end in mind. What do you want to have for this? You want to have a portfolio website. You asked a good question yesterday. What's a portfolio website look like? I don't know. We have to know that because it's habit two, right? Because you fulfilled habit one, you're proactive. You've already built a shell for it, right? Everybody seen CarolineCrest.com yet?
Oh, it's not even like CarolineCrest.com.
Well, it is. Look, when you go to CarolineCrest.com, stuff comes up. Caroline did that. That's her being proactive.
I didn't do any of that. That's just what came with it.
Well,
it's up and running now.
Actually, it didn't come like this. It didn't say a WordPress site before you did something to it. This is a, now, you don't have to say, like, this is great. What I'm saying is, you take responsibility for what you've done. You did this. It's not the way you want it yet, but now you have the freedom to change it. Hello? All right, be right there. Bye. All right, I'll be right back. I'm very proud that you've done that. But think about it, like, now you have so much. There's so much you can do now. Now you can begin with the end in mind. You find your shell. You put first things first. You put your shell in. Then you're going to put content in. Then you put pictures in. You're going to make it look all pretty. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You're doing it completely in order of the Seven Habits.
Yeah.
All right, I'm putting this guy off to sleep. I'll see you. I'll get right back.
Okay.
What was that?
Don't even look at it.
All I did was buy WordPress and launch it. Didn't do anything.
But Kate, can you see where all of this organization that Fritz does allows him to get more done, to be a more effective person.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if all... I can get as much done as he does and manage as many people. And, I mean, he has a lot of fun. He does a lot of work. And then to see kind of how he does it is just absolutely a gift, I think.
Yeah.
It's an opportunity, and some people will take the opportunity and learn from it. And I don't know.
For your business, do you guys have a mission statement?
We just worked on one. Let me get it up here. We have core values, which are pretty much our mission statement, I'd say, right now. We serve responsible and striving people. We work towards sustainability. And we look to optimize contribution in the community. Okay. So that's kind of our mission statement, because we're very new to doing that.
Yeah.
You know, as far as like writing it down. But those are our three core values. We want to make sure that we're sustainable, that we're helping responsible people get better lives, and that we can give back to the community. But like CVS, when I worked there as an intern, they have a mission statement. I don't remember what it was, but it was big. It was a big, long one. And it said, this is what we're all about. And that was really kind of cool. They had done it. I kind of like what, and if we're on habit two, you know, write the book or whatever. I forgot where it's going to go. Oh, they had said something about the epitaph. One way to like jumpstart your mission statement and writing your mission statement was, what do you want to be said when you die? I want people to say that I was a great sister, a fabulous daughter, that I was a good Christian and was very helpful to my community. You know, like, what do you want it to say? And then you write that down. That's pretty much your mission. Yeah. And so that was kind of cool that he did that. I know, Dad, you've done that before, haven't you? Done your epitaph?
Yes, and I'll tell you, Kay, it gets to be very humbling, because if you ever look at the obituaries and see what some people have done with their lives, like in our little town, the epitaphs, the obituaries are bigger, and they go into more detail than some of the bigger cities and everything. But it's always interesting when a person passes, what have they actually done with their lives? And some people, you can tell early on whether they're going to have something to write or not. You know, because there's the people that actually try to do things. It's just like Aunt Terry. She's going to have a lot to write. She's going to have a lot of people there because she's touched so many people's lives. That's one way of doing it. She's out in the public. There are other ways where you're not out in the public, but still you're able to contribute behind the scenes or whatever. But that, I think trying to figure out what your epitaph would be, your obituary will be, is big. That's where I'm at there. So
yeah.
It's getting close to 8 o'clock. How much longer do we want to go? Because Kay's got studies. Right?
Was there any other points on this video that you wanted to make sure you touched on, Kay?
Oh, the ineffective people, when he went through that, it just kind of, like, all of those things combined just seemed like the person was all about worrying about themselves and no one else.
Yes. And that's the difference between being dependent and then independent and interdependent. Which is the first three habits. But then the next three habits make you interdependent. It's when you think win-win. It's when you think about others and you rely on others and you are working toward common goals and that kind of thing. And I think when he was saying about ineffective people, they never get to that point. And it's just that they haven't taken the resources or whatever, but they never get to that point. So they would be very much, and there's so many people like this, like people on welfare.
I'd say there's probably as much as 80% of the people never get into the interdependence, you know, because they're all concerned about their own lives.
It could be a large number, like he's saying. I mean, I just think about all the people that are on welfare, and I think, you know, if they actually said, this is my mission and I'm going to go out and do these things, they probably wouldn't be worrying about their next cigarette and where they're going to find money to do this. And they wouldn't be blaming, you know, they wouldn't be making excuses, et cetera, et cetera. And so.
That kind of reminds me of Gabby Douglas. Have you guys heard her story or seen the movie about her?
I have not seen the movie about her. I know who she is, the Olympian.
Yeah.
The gymnast that won gold.
Yeah, and the all-around and the team. And we watched the movie as a family, and like her family, she was the youngest of four kids, and like her dad and mom like split up when she was like two or three. And so, like, her mom was on her own trying to raise all four of them and everything. And the one thing she promised is that she wouldn't go on welfare, you know, like, she'd keep working so that way she could earn, you know, her way through everything. And, I mean, just how you said, like, the welfare, like, she could have easily just said, all right, well, I have four kids and I want to stay home and take care of them all the time and I'm just going to go on welfare. Like, that'd be an easy thing to do, but she kept doing it. And even when she wanted to put Gabby in gymnastics, she got a credit card for food stamps or something, you know, and she wouldn't use them, and so her kids, the older siblings, just ended up giving up their sports, that way Gabby could do her sport, so that way it would save her mom, so it's kind of like a whole family sacrifice. It was a really cute story. It was really surprising, but
yeah. Hey, it's just exactly like the one we saw on, what was his name? Was Johnson, the doctor, that was two boys being raised by the mother. We just saw here, was it Ben Johnson? Anyway, Two young boys raised by the mother. The mother worked two jobs to keep them off welfare, to give those boys the idea that you can make it, you don't have to be a welfare person. And now he has become a neurosurgeon and all this other stuff and has really been a person that's gone places. But like you were questioning that 80% figure, 50% of the people in the United States, that's half of them, are taking money from the government one way or the other. And there's a whole lot of people that are still making their own way, but they're not contributing. So it's a very high figure on how many of them actually become interdependent.
So where are we?
Another under the mission statement in the beginning of when he was talking about that, with the willpower and imagination and, you know, the things that we have that animals don't, something triggered the vision board for me, because, like, we can imagine it and stuff. Is that where the vision board comes from, or is that like where he got it from, or those two other girls? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, vision boards for him.
And then...
Isn't that cool, okay, that we're the only animal that really has an imagination? They can play out scenarios in our head. Do you know the only reason that we actually rule the earth as opposed to like bears or lions or anything else? It's just that we have strategy because we can think ahead and we can imagine different scenarios in the future and we don't just automatically, we just work on instinct.
We just don't go from memory.
And and there's one other thing that we have over other people. We're designed to run long distances. We will literally track a prey until we kill it. We have more persistence than any other animal. Very strange. When you think about just the evolution of like mankind just in its on its own, we have more persistence than any other. So you couple imagination with persistence, and I think the thing that really separates the like people from anybody else. Very strange animal. Like, we're the only animal that, like, when we're born, we're completely dependent upon our parents. Like, we are helpless. We're the only animal that's actually helpless for years and years being
every
dependent and helpless.
Gets up and walks.
The reason that happens is because our head is so damn big when we're born because the brain is so well developed that the rest of the body is not developed enough to actually be able to sustain life. Yeah. That's why, like, we can think, but at the same time, like, we can't actually take care of ourselves. The rest, they have a fully developed body, but their brain is smaller.
And then the smarter mammals, like elephants, are dependent upon their mothers and their family unit longer.
Mm-hmm.
And they have longer lives and more social and cultural connections. So
very social.
Yeah, so there's different things that I think are interesting as far as the longer you're dependent on your parents, the longer your brain is able to evolve and make you into a more sustainable creature.
So, how do, just out of curiosity, I know this probably doesn't have anything to do with anything, but monkeys, are monkeys, do they have like a, are they kind of more like us, like they're dependent longer?
Yep. Yep, same type thing. Same type thing. But not like animals, like, I mean, look at other animals that like are from egg and stuff like that, that are literally hatched. I mean, they're literally hatched. And then they go. They don't even, they never even know their parents. They're completely self-sustainable right when they're born.
Huh. That'd be horrible.
But they can't actually think.
Yeah.
Hmm. Anyway, what else did you get out of these, Kay?
Well, okay. When he was talking under the mission statement, what makes a mission statement, the four needs, one of them was meaning. And the way he was talking about that, that made me think of our praising that we do. Is that right?
I think so. What do you think, Dad?
Yep, that's right.
Okay. That's all. I mean, I got a lot of things out of the video, but that's all I really had questions or clarifications on.
Right on. Right on. Dad, what else did you get out of this one?
It's just had a lot of the same things that we have been learning all along. You know, it's just like Fritz brings up the idea, you know, no one has power over us unless we give it to them, you know, and that's the way that always happens. The same way with the give a person a fish, and it'll feed them for a day, but if you teach them how to fish, you know, and then we're talking in there about working with people as far as getting the greatest rewards, that it's going to take a long time because they've got a lot of bad habits, and the bad habits are going to take a long time to correct and everything. But the results, the rewards is going to be really good. But, you know, I mean, parents do this a lot, I think, with kids, their children, trying to constantly, you know, get them to do what is going to make them better and everything. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But you have to just keep going and keep going and keep going. And the more you put in, the more you get out. So,
like when he was
that's
talking
about that. But Kate's got...
Even with the mission statement that he was talking about, he was saying that, like, and this is what I was talking about, and I think last week to you, like the process of the mission statement, like the fruit of the mission statement is just as much in the process as it is in the end product. So, like, that's why he, like, warned against, like, don't rush the process. Don't think if you don't have one that that's bad. Don't think if, like, you know, like, don't rush through it. Like, go through, get a draft, then update your draft, then update your draft again. It's a working, breathing document.
Yep.
Don't feel bad about updating it. Don't feel bad about scrapping it and going after completely different things altogether.
Yeah.
You have to go
it's
for what
exactly
actually serves
like
you.
Aunt Donna's favorite phrase that she likes to always bring up, Kay. Be patient, God's not done with me yet. And that's the way it is for all of us all through our life, you know, because we're always upgrading ourselves, trying to become better people. Some of us get a little bit better than others, but it's a lifelong process. It's a journey.
And it's interesting, Kay, like literally, like whenever I went to Date with Destiny, which is the Tony Robbins thing, 3 years ago, and then I went again last year in December, right? And all I did was update mission statements, really, for the most part. Like, that's what you did the whole time while you were there. It was a week-long mission statement. You're really putting it together.
That's cool.
Okay. If you want to go, there's another one in December, so you guys think about it. There's one in December. If you would like to go, I'm sure that, like, we can get a discount because I've been a couple times and stuff like that. So, in any event, it's really powerful. But like when you did what you do is like you go through. I mean, it's very basically it doesn't matter whose system. This one is the most succinct that I've ever found on any of them, like the seven habits. Like, what does Tony do the first long while? You're in charge. You have the power to change your destiny. That's be proactive. Now, begin with the end in mind. In other words, like visualize. What do you actually want? What do you want next? Who are you now? Who do you want to become? And then let's close the gap. And in closing the gap, you have to come up with the person, like, what's the kind of person that it takes to get this up here? Here's where you are. Here's where you want to be. Who does that person have to be? Because their qualities will change. Like, one of my key virtues before, Kay, was focus and execution. That was very important to me for the last 2 or 3 years. Now, for me to become who I want to right now, I have to be more open and grateful. Those are completely different qualities. That's not to say that the other ones were wrong. It's what was necessary at that time. But now, to be who I want to be now, I have to be much more open, and I need to be grateful. It's just, yeah.
When you're thinking about who you are now, you know, and who you want to be, are there different extremes in, like, what's the opposite of extremes, like, minimalistic things that you can do?
I'm sorry, one more time. It was soft.
Okay, so thinking about where you are now and where you want to be, is there, like, a scale, like, you can be this extreme or you can be, like, this minimalistic? on the things to get to you, where you want to be. So, like, you have to find a balance in between.
Okay, small goals don't inspire anyone. Not even you. So if it's not a, if it's not a big goal, if it's not really, really a big deal, like what they always say is like you shoot for the moon, and even if you fail, you land amongst the stars. Right? So at least have your vision as good as what you could possibly see.
No, no, I know that, but on the steps to get there.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, there. Chunk it down. Yeah, you just have to chunk it down. Like, is into bite-sizable type things. So to me, like, I don't really look out. Like, by the time 3 years from now comes, Kay, I won't be able to see past 3 years, really. Because the world changes too much, and so do I. So, like, I don't think I'll be able to see past 3 years. That's just me personally. Therefore, like, I try to make a 3-year vision. Okay, what do I need to do in a year to be on track for that 3-year? Okay, I can visualize that. Okay, what do I need to do in this first quarter? This first 3-month period, because 3 months is enough to maintain some habits, to change kind of some things. It's 3 months, it's still a lot of time. And then you can break it down into other increments, just like I did with like that form I shared with Jared. We do that every month where we talk about it. And even every week, we do little updates. Okay? So, like, it's constant. Like, you don't lose sight of those things. Like, each one of those things is a year or a 3-year long goal. Everything is to get you to there. And it's not even the goal that you're after. You're after the person you become by achieving the goal. It's not really the goal. Like, the but you can chunk it down as little increment as what you want, but you just have to chunk it down to the point to where it doesn't overwhelm you. Because if it's too much, then you won't get started.
Yeah.
Okay. So for you, like if you can think like, what do you want to do when you're out of college, maybe? That's a long-term goal. That's long. That's out there, right? Do you want to even go to college? Like, what kind of person do you want to be? Do you want to be the kind of person that goes to college?
Yeah.
Well, then, you probably want to go to college then. That answers that question, right? That's easy.
Yeah. I was just thinking about, like, I know I want to go to college, so the road for me to go to college and to go to whatever college I want, I can either be minimalistic and, like, you know, shove off my grades and be like, oh, whatever, you know, whatever will happen, you know. But then, like, I could also be, like, every single night I spend the entire night working on my homework and not being happy, but working on my homework so that way my grades are good, so then later I'll be happy. So that's why I asked the question, because I was thinking, like, you can still, like, be in the middle, right? Like, you can have a balance of still being happy, and I mean, even though this will make you happy in the long run, it doesn't make you happy right now. Does that make sense? Okay.
And even knowing that it'll make you happy in the long run, Kay, I think you'll find that you won't hate doing it. Remember the old guy who was trudging up the mountain? Said my vision of the future helps me through any obstacle that I would be going through right now.
Yeah.
So for him, it was easy. Hey, what's up?
Do you want to do goals?
Son of a bee sting. All right, I will be back. All right, bye.
Yeah. All right.
So did we make it by? Do we make it through all of Covey? Already? Anna, you made it through all yours too? All of your applications and insights?
God, yeah, and
good.
I think so.
Okay, good.
Got all my notes. It was really helpful. Got to start on my mission statement from listening to it, so.
So, Kay, I wanted to just take a look at this. Have you seen this quadrant system before?
There we go. There's the quadrants. Yeah, she was talking about this earlier.
Ah, good. Where does Pinterest fall?
Not urgent and not important. Quadrant 4.
Hmm.
She's on it.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. Now,
I know where it falls, and I know I should be doing other stuff.
I know.
It's
but,
just that tiny step of where I actually have to do the other stuff that gets me.
Oh, I get it. Now, do you remember what Stephen said? He had a quote in there, and I wrote it down. I have it on my phone here, but he had a quote. He said, if there's one thing that you could do, it'd be spending time in which other quadrant? Remember exactly what he said?
Quadrant 2.
Yep. Like, yeah, when he was asked if he was to adapt one activity into his life, what would it be? He'd say, increase the time in quadrant 2. By doing so, you spend time in all 7 habits.
Because you're not rushed to do anything, but all those things are important to you. So you're making yourself happy without making yourself stressed out.
Anna, can you give Caroline an example of what you do in quadrant 2 for the houses that keeps you out of quadrant 1?
Prevention. I'll go and make sure that they've all got good roofs, and I'll, before people move in, we look over everything, and if there's here we go. Inspections. I do inspections. They're not urgent, but they are important. And so I do inspections so that I can do preventative maintenance so that there doesn't become a crisis. So I am able to usually find a water leak or a water heater that's going out, and I either fix it as soon as I can, or I can know in the back of my mind that that's going to happen. So the next time I'm at Menards, I'll pick up a water heater. That way when they call me in a couple weeks and say my water heater broke, kind of was expecting that. So quadrant 2, not urgent but important, would be inspections.
100%.
Or looking for houses. Looking for houses. It's not urgent.
Or relationship building. With the tenants or with the help.
Hmm. Anna, do you spend time with relationship building?
Yeah. Every time I do inspection, I talk to the people, see, you know, how things are going in their life, yada, yada. Make sure that the house that they're in is still the best situation for them. And then also when I show houses to them before I rent to them, see who they are, what they're about, if I think they're going to be somebody who's going to be responsible and take care of the place.
How about fruit baskets?
So at what is it called? Valentine's Day, I send flowers to all the people that, like the water company and the bank and the sewer company and all the different people that help me out. Just every day they're doing their job, but there's a lot of times I ask them to help me out, and they don't necessarily have to be nice to me, but they are, and they usually keep me informed of things. And because I send them flowers at Valentine's Day, one girl just called me from the water company and said, hey, if you need any new water meters, the price is going from $500 to $1,300 next month. So I was like, boy, thanks so much. I'll have to look into that. So it wasn't urgent that I send them flowers, but it was definitely important. Because
you had it too, so win-win for both of you.
What?
Yep.
Have it too. Win-win.
Yeah.
That's very much.
Win-win.
Very much win-win. Now, do you see that, Kay? Like that's the stuff that's like, now think about this. How can you apply quadrant 2 to your studies and getting things done early? maybe in the event that you get done with everything by Saturday night, you can Sunday be present with everyone on every phone call, on everything that you're doing the whole time without that nagging in the back of your head. You could take advantage of new opportunities as they come. Mm-hmm. Think of all the other things that you can do quadrant two by getting that stuff done early.
Yeah.
So, like you said, one activity, if you could spend more time in, it would all be in quadrant two, because quadrant two does nothing but helps to eliminate quadrant one. You can spend plenty of time in quadrant three and four, right? Tons of it. How much time can you lose to Facebook and Pinterest?
An hour a day.
More than you'd like to admit, right? But think if you, and you don't have to cut all of it off. You don't have to. Just 15 minutes. If you 15 minutes of, instead of Pinterest, like just take, of the hour, take 15 minutes and move it over to quadrant two. If you don't see anything change and it's not worth it, go ahead and go back to Pinterest for the hour. Fine.
Like sometimes Pinterest, I'll get on Pinterest and almost everything that I pin is ideas for the house or ideas for to paint rooms white rather than dark brown. And so there's different, you know, things that, and maybe it's something that calms you or whatever. So you can find positive, you know, but he's using that as like a time waster thing, not to attack.
And you're not using, like, I'm not saying that everything within Pinterest is useless either, because even in Facebook, you could be relationship building in Facebook. So it's a tool. It's just depending on how you use it, you know, like.
Right. It's like TV. You can use it to be learning things, or you can use it to be shutting your brain off and not being productive.
So, Kay, I know you have a lot going on, so let's wrap this one up. What were our goals for last week?
Anna, start your mission statement and run three times.
Yep.
Yay.
Yay.
Nice. Good work.
I didn't do the mission statement till today. But it's done.
Okay. You got it done.
Let's
start it.
Grandpa, work out four times.
Three times.
What about this next week, Grandpa? How many do you want to do this next week?
Try to get four.
Anna, you doing the same ones next week? Or you have something different? Has to be a little different.
I've got a really big list, a to-do list. So my number one goal is to focus on my to-do list this week, because I do have a lot of other things that are going to try to get in the way. So my number one is focus on my to-do list. My second one is to it's on there. So that's my goal. It's just to make sure that I focus on my to-do list.
Fritz, clean eating.
Yep. Did a pretty good job at clean eating.
What are your goals for next week?
I'm going to clean eat, and I'm going to work out every day of the week this week.
Woohoo! Nice.
I'm finally off the road.
And mine were 10,000 steps, journal three times, and get the book. The book's on reserve. I put it on reserve because they didn't have it. They didn't have either one of them, so the Seven Habits.
Which book do you want?
Habits reserve.
I asked for the teen one, and they didn't have that, and they didn't have the regular Seven Habits. So it's on hold for me. So it should be in this week.
Well, sweetie, you're gonna need to buy those. I'll send those to you on Amazon.
That's what I was just.
You need to have your own copy of those. Those are not those aren't ones you want to do without. So, okay. You'll have them in 2 days.
I don't need both of them.
You'll need both of them.
You may need both.
You have more people in your family, don't you?
Yeah.
Well then.
Okay. 10,000 steps I did. Actually, at like 80-something steps, 80,000-something. Journaling 3 times. I did it 2 times. So, that's better than I've been doing.
That is good. Good. Good for you and your journaling.
I really like journaling. It takes me like 20 minutes to journal at night. And I'm so tired after golf and all my homework. Like, I'm so, like, physically drained that I just want to go to bed. So then I don't do it.
Okay.
But, okay. So my goals for next week are 10,000 steps. And...
Okay, you had 84,000. That's a good... Actually, 89.
Yeah.
89. Dad, you're falling behind. Anna, you're not even in the running. What's going on with you?
I sent my Fitbit back.
Look at who number two is, though, with 107,000 steps.
Holy crap!
Dad, you better tell the girls to pick it up.
You can put it on unit.
107,000. So you tell Walt that he did a great job. Tell him I'm gunning for him this next week.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I don't know what my other goals are this week. I'll add them in. I just haven't thought of them yet.
Okay. All right. So for next week, what kind of one would you like? Would you like something else that's kind of like Cuffy? Would you like to follow up on this?
I mean, it doesn't matter. I would rather do something that you can see. Like, that's an actual video. Because sometimes the audios just really lose my attention and I get really distracted.
All right. Would you like one more week of Steven, though? We can find... Dad, could you find some Steven YouTubes tomorrow? Your best Stephen Covey YouTubes?
I mean, whatever works. I can pull some from the TED Talks. We have a lot in there also.
I know, but I think, like, we can stay within Steven. That way we kind of immerse ourselves with him.
Okay.
Yeah.
Immersions are a good thing. Dad, can you do that for us tomorrow? Can you get those over to Caroline? Your best 30 to 40 minutes of Stephen Covey?
I'll work.
You'll work on it? Thank you, Dad. We appreciate that.
Are we ready for prizing?
We are. Go for it, Anna.
Okay. Fritz, you're the type of person who exemplifies servant leader. Because I have heard you say more than once, what can I do to help you? Which is very empowering to me. Caroline, you are the type of person who's very easy to, or you're very honest and you're very trustworthy, so you're the type of person that it would be easy to give you an upper level position and empower you to do things because it takes a trustworthy and honest person to do that. So going along the Covey lines and everything, you are the type of person who's honest and trustworthy. Dad, you're the type of person who is productive, yet you're really fun. And I've enjoyed hanging out with you this week, putting in my carpet, and I am going to look forward to spending time with you tomorrow and Tuesday cleaning carpet. And I'm the type of person who surrounds myself with positive people.
Yeah.
Ha ha!
All right, Dad, go for it.
Kate, you are an inspiration, and it's such a delight because you do try to do everything you can. Now, if we can work on the organization, you'll become a very productive person. And you're the type of person that's got more BS than most people should have. Fritz, you're very...
That was a compliment from him.
I think it's surprising, Dad. It's surprising for Anna. Like
that is surprising.
Okay.
Fritz, you're the type of person that gets very organized and gets a lot done. And me, I never knew that I was entertaining, but there you go.
Yes, you are, Dad.
But he is. He's the type of person who's very entertaining.
Dad, all right, I'll go next. Dad, you're the kind of person that will help Anna with all of her carpet. And I can tell you take a lot of pride in it, and you really enjoy it. And you're the kind of person that, like, you care a lot about your family, and you care a lot about people. And while I was I hadn't been onto the Disque Foundation website for a little while, so when it was brought to my attention that it hadn't been updated for how many children you have, I had a chance to go back and read it. And all those things are very true. So I had to update it a little bit. And I just recognized what a tremendous life and example that you've given to all of us. So I wanted to thank you for being that kind of person.
Thank you.
Kay, you're the kind of person that inspires me. You're the kind of person that after telling Simon all about you and the foundation, he's so taken by it that he's like, wow, that's pretty amazing. So she puts these on each week. I'm like, yeah, you should be on them too. This would be really fun. You know, like, he wasn't willing to do that because he gets a lot of requests, but he gave me this out of his pocket. It's Simon's Inspire Action, like he has like his golden circle, the why, how, what. Mm-hmm. He took this out of his pocket. This is kind of like his gratitude rock that he has in his pocket all the time. I mean, it's all beat to shit. And he was like,
nice.
he was like, you know, he's like, here, I want you to have this. I can get another one. Like, but like, this is the token to inspire like action. So whenever you touch it, you have to realize that you need to inspire someone. So you're the kind of person that by having me tell him about that, he gave me his Inspire token. And literally, nice. He signed books for 3 hours there and almost missed his flight. And he only had one of these and he gave it to me.
Nice.
So you're the kind of person that can inspire action even from Simon. And I'm the kind of person that can talk him into it. Now, Anna, you're the kind of person that will be on the call every single week and be prepared. Of all the people that are actually on the list that Caroline sends this out to, it means a lot to me that you actually will be on the call every week. You'll have listened to the assignment. You'll see the value in it. And you'll be here with us the whole time, each time, and you're so dependable. That's completely and totally a very, 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 very underappreciated skill. So thank you. Thank you for being the kind of person that will actually even consider thinking about like a mission statement or stuff like that and see that like, listen, we get to live for a long time. We can live it however we want. It doesn't have to be a drudgery. It can be completely what we create. And Anna, you and Kay are like, you're like right at the nexus of it. You're like, you're seeing it. And you're like, this is going to be awesome. This is going to be great. And we'll do it together. And it's so completely awesome. Okay, your turn.
Well, Fritz, you're the kind of person who puts family first, with putting, you know, putting Walt for his for you being a keynote speaker at his career day, with putting that at one of your top priorities and on your monthly exciting things or whatever it's called. And you put family first because you're always on these calls and you always are there for the family, and you just put us first. Grandpa, you're the type of person who also puts family first and is always willing to help, like with Anna and her carpet this week, and is always willing to give your advice and to help others grow. Anna, you're the type of person who is very relatable, at least to me, and always betters herself and is looking for different ways to better herself and other people, and likes to share that with others. I'm the type of person who's going to be working on being proactive this week. Yay!
Nice.
Good job, Kay. Strong work on the website, too. I'm stoked to see it get some legs this week and get your name on it.
Yahoo!
A few pictures. This is going to be awesome. Guys, stay tuned. Stay tuned for CarolineCrest.com.
That was my other goal, is to have the website pretty much done by our next call.
What?
It needs to
pretty
be
much done.
She has till the end of the month.
Yeah.
It's the 21st, so that'd be the 28th. So you better be pretty much done by next call.
That's my goal.
That a girl. Get to it.